Thank you. First, I want to congratulate the American Zionist Movement for having a panel which is dominated by thoughtful, talented women, 75% of women, so I congratulate you. I would associate myself with most of the remarks, although a little bit less so of the latter portion. But I maybe can offer a bit of a different perspective. I had the privilege of representing a district in South Florida in Palm Beach and Broward counties, which many of you may be familiar, which either had the largest or second largest number of Jewish Americans in it. Many of those Jewish Americans were World War II or Korean War veterans, highly patriotic Americans, many of which were committed Zionists, and most, majority, clearly identified with the Democratic Party, but not a single one of them, I think it would be fair to say, viewed Israel in a partisan lens. What I would like to do, I'm not a millennial, but I want to defend them, because I think it's very easy for people my age, 56 and above, to make broad stroke generalizations regarding the commitment of millennials to the security of the state of Israel, and to question that either if they're Jewish Americans, their Jewish identity, or their understanding of the perils that Israel rightfully faces. With all due respect, my orientation, my initial, Anne Lewis said, people's first presidential election frame their politics often, and that's true. I think it would be also accurate to say that one's first familiarity with Israel is often framed by what major event you first come in contact with as a thinking young adult. For people my age, for people a little bit older, it was 1967, the war. That's easy. Israel was right, the aggressors were wrong, and thankfully, thank God, Israel won, and history was written by the right side of that equation. A similar experience could be defined for 1973. I wasn't smart enough as a 6-year-old or a 12-year-old to appreciate either of those events, but I did appreciate Entebbe in 1976. And again, it was easy. The Israelis were right, the other side was wrong, the Israelis were the moral side, the other side were violent terrorists. It was easy to be a 15-year-old Jewish American, proud as can be about my Americanness and about the state of Israel. Now, I don't deserve a medal for that, but let's be honest. If you're 22 years old today, if you're 17 years old today, some of the issues and concerns that relate to the American-Israeli relationship and relate to the situation that Israel finds itself, even for those of us who are the most supportive possible, sometimes find yourself in a zone that isn't necessarily black and white, but is a bit more gray. And in that grayness, there are questions that are raised, doubts sometimes occur, and a degree of self-questioning that happens. I too have had experiences on American universities, and I would beg to differ in terms of the portrayal of American college students, particularly the plight of Jewish American students on campus. And with all due respect to the many fine American Jewish organizations, to a certain degree, some of our difficulties are self-inflicted. And why do I say that? In my experience on American campuses, when I've had the privilege of talking, Oftentimes, what happens is there'll be a large contingency of Jewish students from Hillel, from the variety of Jewish groups on campus. And there will also be a sort of counter group, whether it's the Muslim group on campus or the human rights or whatever group is sometimes pitted adverse to Israel, they'll be there too. And what I will almost without exception find afterwards is that the Jewish kids, more than anything else, will come up to me and say, thank you. Thank you for presenting the strongest case possible for the state of Israel and for why being a Zionist is not only correct strategically, but morally, and you're proud of it. But you do it in terms where you do not deny the credibility of the counter narrative. You can be a committed Zionist, but understand and respect the fact that the Palestinians have a right of self-determination as well. You can be as pro-Israel as humanly possible, and you can understand and appreciate that Israel faces an extraordinary strategic threat in their south from Hamas. You can appreciate that the strategic threat from the north, from Hezbollah, is even greater. You can be totally committed to preventing Iran from developing its undoubted quest to obtain nuclear weapons. You can support every defense measure that the United States contributes with and as a partner with Israel. You can celebrate the type of technology that was mentioned here, and there are others, like the kibbutz in the north, kibbutz Sasa, that's developed the armor vehicle protection, which has literally saved hundreds of lives in the American military from the roadway bombs that took so many of our soldiers' lives in the Iraq War. You can appreciate both the miracle and the greatness of the state of Israel, but also wonder whether settlements that are built outside of the settlement blocks and that undeniably will make achieving a negotiated two-state solution more difficult, whether that is wise policy. We can have that debate respectfully and honestly. And the bipartisan nature of the support of the state of Israel is the greatest asset that we, the American Jewish community, has. But let me close with this, and I'll be less cordial. When President George W. Bush met with President Abbas and persuaded him to allow Hamas to run in the elections in Gaza, that didn't work out so well. I would not dare suggest for one second that President Bush was motivated by anything less than what he thought was an American interest, an Israeli interest, and in the interest of promoting democracy, a sacred American ideal. When President Obama went to Egypt in his first major international speech and lectured, quite frankly, the Arab world about denying Israel's right to exist as a Jewish state like no president had done, but in fairness, may have exaggerated the role that the Holocaust played in terms of the creation of the state of Israel. Criticism is valid, but what did it focus on? The man's an anti-Semite. The man hates Israel. There are dozens of examples, unfortunately, where legitimate criticism towards what might be viewed as more progressive politicians turns into a direct attack on whether or not that politician actually has the best interests of America or Israel at heart. But that doesn't happen. for the most part, the other way around. And so, I'll close with this. We share a common goal. We share the same values and the same objectives. The question is, can we respect those that have differing views in a way where we critique their opinions without completely maligning their commitment to the security and the longevity and the miracle nature of this incredible, unbreakable bond between the United States and Israel? And as to millennials, the minute you tell any millennial, and this just doesn't have to do with Israel, when you tell a millennial to stop thinking, stop questioning, when you tell a millennial it's right or wrong, and you present to that millennial only one side of the equation, sure, they reject the traditional form of wisdom. And with all due respect to those that play leadership roles in the American Jewish community, that is what we are largely feeding people with respect to issues that relate to Israel. To me, the greatness of Israel is that the truth sells. The truth about Israel is an extraordinary miracle. There is no country in this planet that is more moral. No military that is more moral in its behavior. But that doesn't mean it's perfect, just like America isn't perfect. But when we go on campus, do we offer Jewish American students a honest, objective discussion where Israel 80% of the time or 90% of the time can be portrayed in extraordinarily highest equations? No. We tell them it's 100%, and if you question it, you're on the other side of the equation. That's not a very strategic manner of persuasion, with all due respect. And the other thing, I didn't support Senator Sanders. I don't support him for a whole host of reasons. But it's also not fair to say that he is the representative of the progressive wing of the Democratic Party as it relates to Israel. His campaign had nothing to do with Israel. It had a whole lot to do with health care. It had a whole lot to do with worker rights. It had a whole lot to do with domestic issues. The man never mentioned Israel, even though he was the first Jewish American to ever win the presidential primary. And when he did, it wasn't so complimentary. That is not representative, with all due respect, of the progressive wing of the Democratic Party. I live there, I breathe there, I can tell you with absolute certainty that wishing for the days of Hubert Humphrey and Scoop Jackson, sure, that's wonderful. There are the Scoop Jacksons and the Hubert Humphreys right here. And it is somewhat funny, and I'll stop, I promise. Chuck Schumer is the minority leader in the United States Senate. Is Chuck Schumer not as pro-Israel as Hubert Humphrey or Scoop Jackson? I think so.